What's going on, guys? Pete here with MixBetterNow.com. Finally coming to you with the brand new Mix Critique Monday. It is Monday, April 17th, 2017. You're probably like, dude, where you been the last two Mondays, man? Well, I do apologize. A long story short, I had ScreenFlow take a massive, massive dump on me on the 3rd. So I've literally been down for 2 weeks and haven't been able to do any new videos. I actually shot last week's Mix Critique Monday, went to go hit save, started to edit it, didn't save the Mix Critique Monday, and I couldn't open ScreenFlow. So about 10 back and forths later with Telestream support, big ups to my man Abdul at Telestream. If you guys have any ScreenFlow issues, make sure you talk to Abdul. He knows what's up. So he got me back up and sorted. I put a few videos up, I guess last week, but I had already shot those and those were already sort of hanging out waiting to go for some different projects. One thing I did for Plugin Alliance, another thing I did for Warren over at Produce Like a Pro. So anyway, I do apologize that we haven't had these up. So what I'm going to do to try and sort of get the ball rolling a little bit more here, because we are a little bit backed out, today we got four mixes on deck instead of our usual three. I'm going to try and get through it a little bit quicker. I'm not going to do any less, give any less input. I'm just going to try and move a little bit faster. And then I think what we're going to do is next week we can do five mixes. So that'll sort of make up for the six. Well, I know that'll technically be three, but we'll kind of catch up 1 week, but we'll still be a week behind. I've never been good at math. So anyway, if you guys are new to Mix Critique Monday, welcome. Big welcome. Hope you all had a good Easter for those of you who celebrate Easter. Mix Critique Monday is a platform for you to get free mix critiques, okay? It's a positive place. It's a safe place to get another set of ears on your mix, okay? Everything I say is in a positive manner. Everything I say is with the your best intentions in mind. I want to help you get the best mixes you possibly can. Please don't think anything I say is negative or malicious, because it certainly is not. If you would like a free mix critique, all you have to do is email me, pete@mixbetternow.com. Please include your name, the name of the mix, the name of the artist if it's different from yourself, and please try and send me a downloadable WAV file. I prefer WAV files because they have better audio resolution than MP3s, okay? AIFFs work, you know, also if you're in Logic or something like that. MP3s are okay. You know, and if you're going to send an MP3, try and make it like a 256 or a 320. K or something like that. So, first come, first serve. I basically put them in line when I get them. That's really it. Without further ado, let's just jump in. We've got some cool variety this week, and we've got two really like super gnarly metal tunes, at least the first one. So this week we've got mixes from John Hobdy. Am I saying that right? Hobdy. Yeah, I don't have my glasses on. I never have my glasses on. The song is called Precipice by the band Inversions, all right? John Hobdy, Precipice by Inversions. Following that is my man Kevin Goff with a very cool tune, Isn't She Funky, by the band Triskemi Rescue. Following that is my man Efraim Valderamma. Thank you for being patient, Efraim. I appreciate it, man. I know you were like, dude, where the heck is the... Where's the Mix Critique Mondays? His mix is called Libertad by the band Silas Mind. Silas Mind? Silas Mind? Let me know, Efraim, if I'm saying that wrong. I say everything wrong. last up, we've got my man Adam Kirally going back to Zion. All right, so we got a cool little blend of, we've got like two metal tunes, a funk tune, and a really cool worship song. All right, so we're just going to jump into it. First up here, Precipice by Inversions, John Hobbs.
Oh!
Excuse me. Man, I really love it so far. I think everything sounds awesome. I love the huge guitars. I think the guitars sound really good. They're really big. Drums sound on point. I can hear the bass. I can hear the vocals okay. Right here, though, the only thing I'm noticing is that the kick's a little loud. I would pull the kick down a little bit here. Maybe the overall volume. I think dynamics are so cool in songs, right? Like the when you could sort of take a person on a musical journey and sort of, you know, pull it back and then bring it back when it comes in and just really hit them in the face. I love that. So the kick is just a little loud right there. You know what I just realized I need to do? I need to take my return to start on stop off. There we go. Yeah, I would definitely just pull that down a little bit, because for me, it's taking away from the other parts. You know, if we don't have a mix that is really just balanced, well, I mean, that's all mixing really was at the start, was getting levels for everything. Because back in the day, there, you know, EQ outboard EQs were basically made to fix bad miking. So when they wanted to get stuff to sound how they wanted it to sound, they would mic it appropriately. If they wanted it louder and to sound a little bit darker, they would move the mic closer for proximity effect and all that stuff, or they would change the microphone out. So anyway, I would just pull that down, because it sort of distracts me from guitars that are sort of playing like those clean arpeggiated licks out wide are a little loud for me. They're kind of dominating everything. Love that real cool, like, exploding. Only thing I would do is that the tail on that reverb sounds a little bit muddy. Make sure you're EQing after your reverb on your send, or if you have it on your track as an insert. Okay, so maybe you put it on your snare bus as an insert, and you're just kind of using the dry wet knob. A lot of reverb plugins these days do have high and low pass filters on them. I always like to make sure, like that, like where I'm hearing a muddy reverb, I'll roll off quite a bit of the bottom with a high pass filter. If I'm doing something where I hear like a vocal through a reverb on a send, and it's making stuff look like a bit brighter. I will roll off a bunch of the top with a high pass filter, probably down to something like 10K. But I'll usually remove anything on a reverb. I'll EQ anything out like below 200 hertz just because I don't really need it, you know, unless. Man, awesome mix. Super, super good job. John, killing it, man. I didn't really have much problem with any of that. I thought everything sounded really good. I liked a lot of the levels. I liked the way the guitar sounded great. Let me know. I'm curious, John. Let me know if you used, you know, what you did to track the guitars. They were sounding real good. They weren't sounding overtly fizzy to me like you were using. As you guys know, I'm probably not a massive fan of amp sims, but if you did use an amp sim, let me know, because that was certainly getting the job done. I thought the drums were cool. Love to know what you use on the drums too. You know, maybe like a superior drummer kit or something like that, or an addictive drums. But it was definitely chosen well. The bass was in a good spot. Your low end was managed well. It wasn't overtly bright. There wasn't any weird nasally, you know, honky, mid-rangey things happening in the mix. And my only beef was really with how loud the kick was during the breakdowns. I'd pull that down a little bit, maybe pull the overall volume of that down a little bit on a little automation, so that when the chord, you know, when the song gets back up to normal volume, it really kind of hits the listener. But really, really good job. I don't get a ton of metal tunes on here, and if it's not metal, I apologize. I know there's like many subgenres of metal. There's like, you know, insert word here, core, which is great. I totally dig metal. I'm not a big metal listener, so John, hopefully you can educate me a little bit on that, man. But I totally dug it. I thought it was a stellar mix, and I would say just tweak the kick, throw it on a record, and you're good to go, man. That's a really outstanding job. So well done, John Hovde, Precipice by Inversions. Loved it. Next up, cruising along, Isn't She Funky? Very cool song by my man. Love the horns. I always thought you were the sweetest thing. The way you look at me, it feeds my soul and it makes it sing. Ain't I a junkie? Ain't I a junkie? Come and get it, this electrical breakdown. All right, cool. A couple things that I'm hearing. There's a little lack of low end happening, and I don't mean like I can't hear the lows. I mean, like, there's certain things, like, I would love to hear a kick with a lot more weight to it. I know the bass is sort of kind of doing two different things. There's a slap bass part, and then there's a there's sort of like a more straight ahead bass line. I'm also hearing a little something in the mid range. So the first thing I want to do is let's grab a pull tech. Something that I like to do when I want to add a little bit of heft and a little bit of weight to the kick into the bass is I will do what's called like the pull tech trick, where you can boost and attenuate the same frequency on the low end at the same time. So I've got the EQP1A pulled up, and you can boost and cut 20, 30, 60, or 100 hertz, all right? And what's cool about that is it does this sort of, I know it almost sounds counterintuitive if you're going to like boost 3 dB of 20 and cut 3 dB of 20 or 60 or whatever, like it'll cancel each other out, but it actually doesn't. It creates this sort of bump. Like if you're looking at a like a parametric EQ and you actually see the curve that it imparts, it's very unique. I actually have, it'd be actually something cool to show, I think, in another video, but I got my hands on an original manual to one of an original Pultec online somewhere. And it's great because they show you what the curves look like inside of the manual when you're doing certain boosting and attenuating functions. So it's really interesting, but check it out. So one thing I like to do on my mix bus, maybe you guys have seen me do this before, maybe not. I've done it a bunch of times in different different videos, is that you can take 20, and I know 20 sounds absurd, but I saw Greg Wells do this. I don't know. I forget where I saw him do this, but Greg's brilliant. He takes 20 hertz, and he will put it on the mix bus, and it'll boost like 3 or 4 dB, and then he'll attenuate or cut one less. And what that does is it just brings out the low end in a beautiful way. And I know, you know, 20 is weird because it's sort of hard to hear 20 and all that stuff. You know, I would think 60 or 100 would sort of work better. You know, and those are cool to add low end to certain things on. But when you're boosting and cutting, 20 just sort of does it for me. So let's try and boost 4 dB at 20 and we'll cut 3. I'll flip the switch in and out. So up is in, down is out. Run and they can see you hide. Everybody's tired, every courage and pride. Keep it cool, I'm a fool for your games. I'll play them again. Isn't she funky? I'm feeling lucky. I ask myself this every day. Ooh, yeah. Come and get it, this electrical breakdown. Funny girl, you're going through my heart. I don't know if you guys can hear that, but for me, it's just adding a little bit of weight to the kick, which I really like. So, you know, there's some different ways that we can go about approaching this. The pull tech on the mix bus is one of them, Kevin, but of course you have the ability to certainly go in and, you know, do things to your kick, you know, to make it sound a little bit bigger. Another thing I really like to do to my kick is I like to, let me just grab a 1073 plugin of some sort. Doesn't matter which 1073 you use, but if we took something like the Wave Shep 73, I like to use the high pass filter here. So like I'll put this on the kick, engage the high pass. So, you know, we're kind of rolling off everything below 50, but we're really not, but we are. And then I'll take 35 here on the low shelf and I'll boost the low shelf. That'll get a whole bunch of weight in a really nice area, and it'll give you a lot of, you know, thwomp, thwomp, kind of a lot more of that as opposed to the attack or the click of the beater head. If you want more click and more attack, I'll come up here to like 4.8 or 7.2 or the 3.2 in the mid band at the bell, and I'll boost a little bit of this, and this will give me more attack. But then if I boost the 35 with the high pass filter, that'll give me some more of the low end. So just another option for you, just something to consider, some food for thought. Last thing I'm hearing here is we got a little bit of a little bit of honkiness, a little bit of nasaliness going on. So this is what I'm taking out. Some 300. Let's see if I... Baby, you can always count on me. Please don't worry, there's no worry, let the begin. Okay, so what I'm hearing really, Kevin, that's going on is that mid-range nasal thing is kind of happening in the vocals. When the vocals come in, I feel like that cut is making it sound better, and then when it's just kind of doing it the instrumental thing, it's sort of, it's not. So I would say go back and check out the mid-range or the low. You know, just some food for thought. I always do some cuts in that area on my mix bus all the time, all the time, because we're always going to get buildup, right? The more stuff that we sort of want to run out through two channels, you know, whether it's a 10 track session or whether it's a 100 track session, you're going to get resonance buildup. And, you know, I'll always have that EQ on the mix bus, and I'll just tend to sort of tweak things as I mix, because it's important to kind of take certain things out, because even if you if you EQ individual tracks, you know, you can still have some funny things happen on the mix bus. All right. Come and get it, this electrical breakdown. Funny current going through my heart. Don't forget about this feeling that we found. Words unmistakable. Come on and tell me, what do you need? 'Cause baby, you can always count on me. Please don't worry, there's no hurry. Let the beat keep moving your feet. Is it G-Funk? Sweet tune, man. Really good job. Again, another really great mix. Kevin killing it. Isn't She Funky by Triskemi Rescue. Really good job. Loved the fact that there were some live horns in there. Trumpet, saxophones. I thought the guitars were cool. Love the drums. Definitely an acoustic kit in there. The drums sounded really good. I thought they were recorded really well. And the guitars sounded good. So, you know, they definitely sound like they were kind of amp simmy, but I thought they were appropriate. I really love what was kind of chugging along. The only thing I heard at the end of that was the guitars on my right that was playing the chick was a little bit loud. Could have probably came down a couple dB. But again, not much to really pick apart there. My biggest issue was with some of the way the tonality of the vocals. There were some mid-range issues I was at, or low mids, I should say, that issues I was having, you know, in that area that I would probably clean up, pull out with some subtractive EQ. You know, all in all, really good job for sure. Really enjoyed that. Pleasure to listen to. Love the balance of things. Thought it was a tasteful use of EQ, of effects. Love. It was a perfect example of how you can make a vocal wet without it sounding wet. And what that does, instead of being right here, it just kind of brings it back into the mix. So super good job, Kevin. Thank you for sharing that. Next up, my man, EFRAIM Valderamma, all the way from, I'm going to get this wrong. It's either, I believe it's Argentina. So Argentina in the house for sure. Libertad by Silas Mind, mixed by EFRAIM Valderamma. This is another super fun, sort of, like a Latin metal tune, not like Latin, but you know, obviously in Spanish. So let's jump in and check. I just want to say that I love right away that I'm hearing the fact that you've got some real cool kungas, or it sounds like kungas, not over bongos. They sound a little bit bigger. Yo quiero ser feliz. Yo quiero libertad. So we need to talk about these vocals a little bit. Very cool tune, digging it so far, EFRAIM. Having a little bit of an issue with the sung vocals, okay? Two things that I'm hearing are they sound a bit muddy. Excuse me. And they also are a little dry. Not that dry vocals are bad, but they're dry, like they're very forward. They're very forward sounding in the context of the mix. Like, you know, the music's sort of here and the vocals are here, you know, as opposed to sounding like one cohesive unit, one cohesive thing. So, you know, very simply put, easy way to fix that is to go ahead and make sure you're doing some subtractive EQ on your vocals, make sure you're cleaning them up, you know, high pass filter, looking for any muddiness, 150, 200, 250, something around there. Always check for some boxy nasaliness, 400, 450. I mean, it could even be 300, but you know, it depends vocalist to vocalist, whatever microphone you use, whatever the situation is, it can constantly change. I'm just throwing out some usual suspect areas. I think by doing some subtractive moves in there, you'll clean it up and it'll make it pop a lot more. Like you're not really gonna need to, you know, like if I hear a dull sounding vocal or a muddy sounding vocal, my natural intuition is not to grab, you know, the top end and to boost it. It's to sort of find those problematic areas and get rid of them, because my whole thing is get rid of what you don't need. Just get rid of it instead of trying to, you know, dance around it. Because if you cut the lows, you're going to inherently make the top end sound brighter because you're removing some low end information. So I would definitely do that. And then also, you know, depending on how dry or wet you want the vocals to sound, you know, definitely put some a little bit of effects on there to wetten it up a bit more. You know, it can be as subtle or as dramatic as you want. You can do some small room sounds. I like doing what I call an office verb that I stole from Fab over at Pure Mix. Fab is great. He uses there's a preset in the Sonics Oxford Reverb that is probably one of my favorite native reverbs. That's called Office, and it's a very small room. And what it's great about it is when you put it on a vocal, particularly, it just kind of, instead of, you know, goes from here to here, just moves it back a little bit. Doesn't necessarily make it sound wet. It just adds some depth to the vocal. You could also use delay to achieve that. Okay, real short delay, 70 millisecond, 60 millisecond delay, or a 64th note, or a 32nd note delay, depending on how it sounds. Turn the repeats all the way off, so you're not actually having it repeat and delay out. You're just getting that initial, that one repeat, and it's just whoop, right back. Another thing you could try is maybe doing some chorusing, and I don't mean, you know, I say this all the time, I don't mean like super 80s chorused out, you know, guitar. I mean using something like a Roland Dimension D in that fashion, or, you know, doing like an Eventide H3000 pitch shift thing where it's sort of just chorusing a little bit on both sides. You can use stuff like, you know, the UAD makes the Roland. Now it's something else. They changed their licensing thing with Roland. The one I like is Microshift from SoundToys. That thing's awesome. I use it all the time. With a Waves Doubler, that'll also do something similar. And again, it's just going to, you know, it's just going to kind of do this to both sides, you know, like a +3 and a -3. So it's just sort of doing a little bit of this, not a super big chorus, but that will also give you a little bit of depth. You could use all three of those. A very little, you know, a pinch of a short room verb, or a very short plate, you know, not a lot, a very short delay, and a little bit of chorusing or doubling or whatever you want to call it. When the screaming vocals come in here, it's better, because I'm hearing a little effect on there, and they're not muddy. They're kind of they're coming through and they're cutting, and I could hear them in a much better. They're sitting in a much better place. So.
Who can't wait?
Yeah, right on. Really nice job, Ephraim. Listen, one more thing I wanted to talk about that I want to mention that I was hearing. I didn't want to interrupt the rest of the mix, but the kick. Okay, so with this kind of music, I feel like the kick is a very important aspect of, you know, of heavier rock and metal and stuff like that. And to me, the kick was a little bit pillowy, a little on the pillowy side. What do I mean by pillowy? I mean it was a little fluffy sounding. It didn't have as much sort of attack and smack as I sort of would want to hear in something like that. Like it almost sounds like it's hitting a... No, that's a bad example too. I don't have a pillow laying around, but think about like when you hit a pillow, right? It's almost a softer sort of sound. I feel like I could use some more attack on there, but not just attack, also some more heft to the low end of the kick. So a great way to do that would be to high pass the kick, add a little bit of a resonance boost where the fundamental of the kick is. So just to give you an idea of what I mean, so let's just say, now keep in mind, I put a high pass filter on everything. Some people like to teach, oh yeah, put a high pass filter on everything except your low end instruments like your kick and your bass and your, you know, so on and so forth. And maybe that works for some people, but I find that I need to put a high pass filter on everything, literally everything. My kick drums, my bass, my mix bus. If I have other low end stuff like cellos or sub synths, I am high passing everything because we really can't hear like 15 hertz, 20 hertz. I mean, it's super hard to hear that. And think about how most people consume music these days, right? It's different than it was 15, 20 years ago when people have... you know, hi-fis in their room or little Sony boomboxes. Remember the Iowa systems? I don't know if I'm showing my age here right now or anything like that. But, you know, when I listen on earbuds, I hate earbuds. Earbuds sound terrible just in general. But, you know, sometimes I do it too. I listen to music on my phone, on my tablet, you know, with all of these modern day things, you know, Bluetooth speakers. And let's be honest, they're convenient, but they don't sound good like for anything. So, you have to sort of figure what your audience is and where they're going to be listening to it. And, you know, I don't care what phone anybody has. You're not going to hear 20 hertz on a phone. So nonetheless, I high pass everything. Here's what it would look like. You high pass, let's say you're rolling off 30, right? Well, then you take like a bell and, you know, you could do a little something like this. So let's say you want to push up some 35. Okay, this is sort of what I was talking about with the Neve before. This is what it looks like. With the Neve in particular, what that does is it high passes to 50, and then instead of a bell here, it's a low shelf. And what the low shelf does is this is at 35, and then when you raise this, you sort of get something that looks like that. Okay, I know it's extreme, but you get this bump and then you know your filter is kind of hanging out. And you could even bring this up a little bit more, but you sort of get my idea, right? It's you're going to get this hump here. It's a little bit easier to show if it's a bell shape. Right? So you can do something like this. But what that does is it lets the fundamental come through, which is going to give you that low end weight. But you're going to get rid of all the subby stuff that kind of doesn't sound good on the bottom. And then you're going to want to find your point of attack. Now, I happen to know that the attack of a beater, you know, a beater head on a kick drum, whoops. I'll usually do something around 3K, anywhere from like 3K to 4K. It can be all the way up to 7K. It really just depends on what it is. But, you know, you're going to be somewhere around here. And, I don't know why that keeps doing that. So anyway, it's going to look something like that if you're using a parametric EQ, but make sure you're taking care of the kick there because you really, really, really want it to come through. I was just having a tough time hearing a lot of the kick there. And in my opinion, in this type of... like all of the heavier stuff, the like that for me is coming from the... It's not that I can't hear the kick. It's that I can't hear the kick as much as I want to. So listen to it there. And let's go back to... Right? So you hear more of that point on the kick, more of that smack that you would get from, you know, see what I'm saying? So, but the good news is that those are easy fixes. The other thing was the vocals that I was talking about. So I think if you work on those two aspects there, Ephraim, you're going to be rocking, man. You're going to be good to go. Awesome. Three very cool mixes so far. We're going to finish it up today with an awesome worship song from my man Adam Kirally. This is called Going Back to
Looking out west beyond the horizon line. There lies a place that we call home. In the mountains there beside the sea, the city in the clouds is calling us home. Down by the rivers of Babylon, we hung our hearts. We raised our voices and cried to our God to be free. We're going back to Zion.
Adam, solid job so far, man. I think this might be your best mix yet. I think you've had, two mixes before this on here? And definitely your best effort so far. I'm hearing some stuff in your vocal that I think can come out, again, a little bit of that low end. It sounds I'm hearing a little bit of muddiness. It's not as... sort of as lucid as it could sound, not as clear as it could sound. I typically on a vocal, just to show you if I'm high passing, on a vocal, I really don't need anything below 80 ever, unless it's someone playing an acoustic guitar and singing. That's it. You know, I'll tend to leave all the stuff in to make it sound like, to fill out the, all the frequencies, but when you've got a band in there, rarely do I need anything below 80. I'll even find myself, going up to 150 on male vocals a lot of the time. So that being said, if I'm EQing vocals and I want to take out some muddiness, I'll come up to about 130. I've got my bell, and then usually right where the sweet spot is for me is right around where the slope of the filter starts. I'll usually pull a little bit of that out like that. It'll just open it up. It'll clean it up a little bit. It'll take care of some of that muddiness. And then the next thing I'll always do is I'll sort of look for some of that nasal boxiness that just happens. And it can be anywhere from 400, to 700. So somewhere in here. So if you see a lot of my EQ cuts on male lead vocals, they'll typically look something like that a lot of the time. And I think by going in and searching for some of that, I think you would certainly find a little bit more clarity, and your vocal is going to sound more open. Just for fun, I want to sort of see if we can cut out some. All right, so I'm hearing the bass and the bass and sort of the snare, some of the drums are clashing around the 200 area.
From all captivity, Babylon is falling and your people come forth, lead us home.
So I'm taking a little of that out. And I think you can hear it really when the snare hits there. So you can do a little bit of subtractive EQ on the snare. You know, and sort of where the bass is hitting is I would say in this 200 area. Let's bypass.
Just heard something with that kick.
Going back.
Going back. Hearts rejoice. Going back.
You know what I mean by basket? Like you're sort of bouncing a basketball on a gym floor, right? It's kind of got that. And that can be desirable in certain applications and in others maybe not. To me, it's not a natural kick drum sound. So, you know, I don't know what you track the drums with. If these are acoustic drums or if you're using something like Easy Drummer, which is great. You know, if it is Easy Drummer, the good news is you can just swap out that kick drum for maybe a different kick that might sound a little bit more natural. But I tend to find that if something sounds a little bit basketball-y, it's something in the low mids that's maybe resonating in an awkward way, a little bit honky maybe. On a positive note, though, I think I really like the acoustic guitars. I think they sound great, and I think I like the effects on your vocal, like the blend that you have, sort of how far back they're sitting in the context of the mix to the music. I really like that a lot. You know, I kind of like the... you know, the vibe of the snare is cool. You know, might be clashing, like I said, a little bit with the bass, but nonetheless, I do like the idea. These are just some things that you can clean up. You know, but you've already.
Back to Zion. Lead us on the way. Lead us on the way, lead us on the way home. Lead us on the way, lead us on the way, lead us on the way home. Lead us on the way, lead us on the way, lead us on the way.
Cool, man. Solid, solid job.
We're back to Zion.
I'm hearing just a hint of a little bit of muddiness on that acoustic. Something in the look around 150, 200 area. I think you could pull that out. Really good job, man. A couple other things that I'm hearing is some of the musicianship can sort of be tightened up. You know, some of the drum hits are just a little off. I think the bass could be a little bit tighter. All in all, you know, performance is a big part of a mix, right? Everybody thinks of mixing as, you know, you can fix mixes or you can do these magical things with plugins or with editing tools. And really what it boils down to is really good mixes are always really good recordings of really good performances, like anywhere on any record with anything. That's pretty much, you know, how it is. You can only mix what is in front of you. Simple as that. If it's lacking in some way, if the performance is subpar, and I'm not saying your performance is subpar at all. That's not what I'm alluding to. But you know, if it's not as good as it can be, like if you're the musician, as I hit my mic, if I'm the musician, say, right, and I do some takes and I'm tracking, and you know, in my heart, I know I could do a better take, or I know I could do a better job. Instead of being, you know, it's so easy for all of us to be lazy and be like, oh man, you know what? I'll fix it in the mix. I'll do it later. Life is real easy when you get it, you know, when you get it right, when you're tracking. So, you know, just something to consider. I know you're a good musician, Adam, and, you know, great tune, man, super good performance. You know, but just always ask yourself, you know, can I play it better? Can I make it tighter? Can I? You know, that's part of striving for getting better, right? And I always say that the best mixes I've ever done sort of mix themselves. They're always good tunes, and they're always great recordings and great performances. So all in all, though, man, really solid job. I definitely think that is your best mix to date. So well done. Couple issues there that I was talking about, but I think if you go back and address some of those things, you will be, you know, well on your way. My biggest issue overall was just with the vocal. I think you can do some subtractive EQ to some of the low mids and you know, some of the, a little bit of that boxy area. Try pulling out some 600 on your vocal. I think you'll find a lot of joy getting rid of some of that. So, and I think it'll sit better in your mix. But big thanks to the four of you guys today, and thanks everyone for being a little patient with me while I was dealing with all this screen flow stuff. Pretty lame. Felt you know, it's a pretty bad feeling when you don't know what's going on. I actually thought I was going to have to completely reinstall my OS X and, you know, just swipe it, back it up, swipe it, and then reinstall everything, because for, you know, for what, 10, 12 days, no idea what was going on. So anyway, we got that out of the way. Mixes today. Precipice by Inversions from John Hobdy. Isn't She Funky by the band Trisca Me Rescue, mixed by Kevin Goff. Song Libertad by Solace Mind. Mixed by EFRAIM VALDERAMMA, and of course, Going Back to Zion from Adam Crowley. Really good job to the four of you. Thank you guys all for submitting. I appreciate it, and as always, you guys definitely impress me every week. Again, if you are new and you don't know the deal here, if you would like a free mix critique, if you would like to be on a Mix Critique Monday, all you have to do is email me, pete@mixbetternow.com. Send me a downloadable WAV file of your mix, preferably a WAV file, okay? Please include your name, the name of the song, the name of the mix, and then the name of the artist or the band if it is different from yours. And it's first come, first serve. I put them in line as soon as I get them, and that's really it. So, I hope to get some more mixes for you guys in the future, and please keep up the good work. If any of you guys have any questions, leave them below or shoot me an email. And if you guys aren't subscribed already to the YouTube channel, make sure you subscribe. If you're not on the Mix Better Now email list, make sure you jump on the email list. When you do, I will send you my free audio swag bag, which is, it's got tons of stuff in there for you. It's got free multi-track sessions. We've got free mix templates for Pro Tools, for Cubase, for Logic, for Studio One, for a bunch of different DAWs. We have free drum samples, free Bricasti reverb impulse responses, and then also a tutorial for me going through all my mix templates and showing you how the routing works and all that stuff. So, you know, it's a no-brainer. Make sure you jump on the email list. There'll be a link below that'll take you there where you could sign up, and you will automatically get your free swag bag. So, that's it for me today. My name is Pete with MixBetterNow.com. As always, guys, I appreciate you. I appreciate your time. Appreciate you watching. I hope you all have an awesome day. I hope you all had a great Easter weekend, and I will catch you next time. See ya.